Welcome to Office 2013 video project number 27. Hey, if you want to download this workbook, and this is video 23 to 27 workbook, click on the link below the video or go to our class website. Hey, this is Excel. We're still studying Excel. This is Excel Basics number 9, and we want to talk about keeping data in Excel, either with a proper data set or the amazing Excel table feature. Now, we've already been talking about proper data set. In order to do pivot tables and sorting, you have to have a proper data set. So we've talked about this before, but here we'll formalize it with these four characteristics of a proper data set. Field names in the first row. So for this stock table example, each field name says what kind of data gets to go in this column. Now, not only is it useful for us, because when we're filling out each record, we know to put the price in the column that says price, earnings per share in the column that says earnings per share. But if we do pivot tables, we've seen already in the class that these show up in our field list, which allows us to drag and drop. Okay, so field names in the first row. No empty field names, right? If you have an empty field name, it's no good for the person using the table because then they don't know what data goes there. And then for pivot tables, it's not going to work. Records are in subsequent rows. That just means you have a collection of related data. So in this example, it's for each stock we have. Earlier in our example, or I'll scroll down here. Here's our example we've been using throughout the class. Each one is a different transaction, a different sale. Down here, we'll have a medical example where we have collected different blood pressure readings. So each blood pressure reading is a new record because it's a new recording for a new day. Each record is a collection of related data. Number four, try not to have empty cells in the record. If you have, for example, an empty cell, occasionally when you do a pivot table, then the calculation gets a little messed up. It's easy enough to fix. But in a perfect world, you'd have no empty cells in any of your records. Finally, you must have empty cells all around your data set. So all the way, even though that word names right there looks like it's right next to the data set, it's not, because all that data is sitting in cell B8. It's just hanging out. So this entire data set has empty cells all the way around. You can't do sorting or filtering or pivot tables if you don't have empty cells all the way around. Notice I have this label up here, but I'm not touching the data set. Now, the data sets can be touching row headers. That means Excel row headers. Or they could be touching the column headers up here. But all the way around, empty cells. The thing that people do that messes up pivot tables and sorting sometimes is maybe they have, you know, like a note here. Forget it. You got to have a notes column. If you're going to have a note here, then put it one, in this case, column to the right. All right, so those five things. As long as you have those things, you can do amazing things. The data ribbon, filtering, sorting, some other features here we'll see later. And we saw a couple videos ago, we added our pivot table button here and our data ribbon. So those are the five rules for proper data set. Now, if we have a proper data set, let's just remind ourselves. Let's do our pivot table. I'm going to click in a single cell, Alt-N-V, as we learned a couple videos ago. I'm going to put this in an existing. Actually, let's do this on a new worksheet. We haven't done a new worksheet yet. Our goal here is simply to do sales rep, and then the total sales. And we want to look at the field list now that we know what a proper data set is. So new worksheet, and then click OK. Now notice there's going to be a new worksheet down here when I click OK. And immediately, I'm going to double-click this and call it PT1 or something. That is our pivot table 1. Here's the field list. And you know, if we didn't have a proper data set, how in the world would we know which fields to drag where? So proper data sets are amazing. All right, sales rep, down to the rows. Sales, down to the values. All right, so that's just a quick example of proper data sets We've got to have proper data sets so we can do amazing things like pivot tables. Let's go back over to Excel tables. Of course, sorting. So here's a great example. I want to sort and get all the biggest values to the top. So right-click Sort. You could do it that way. Notice A to Z. Or with a single cell, you could go up to Data and use the A to Z. Now, that'll bring the smallest. I think I said the biggest. So I want Z to A. Just like that. Proper data sets for doing data analysis. Now, we're going to see the Excel table feature. This was added in all the way back in 2003, but it wasn't called a table till 2007. So 7, 10, and we're studying 13 here. Here's what an Excel table will do. Well, first, you got to have a proper data set. You got to have field names at the top and records and rows. But this is what it will do. It'll actually create dynamic ranges. That means as we add new records, our formulas that are pointing at our Excel table, or we're going to make a chart. The chart, if it's pointing at an Excel table, as we add new records, or in this case, blood pressure readings, the chart will just update. The formulas will just update. As we add new records, notice the range would expand. If we added one single record, it would expand there. Add two extra records, it would expand there. So dynamic ranges, that means we no longer have to keep creating new formulas or charts every time we add new records. It'll just happen automatically. Table feature will add formatting. It will also add sorting and filtering buttons to the top. Here's how you do it. Click in a single cell and go to Insert, and we saw pivot table. There's table. Now, if you do tables a lot, the keyboard is right there, Control-T. So that's what I'm going to use, Control-T. It's polite. It says, hey, my table has headers. If you don't have headers, you better, your field names, you better add them. I'm going to click OK. Oh, look at that. There's the formatting, just like that. Now, if you don't like the formatting, you just come up to Design and pick a different format. But before we do anything, let's name this table. We've been talking about naming in this class, naming our folders, naming our files, naming our sheet tabs. So let's name this table. Oh, look, as soon as we create a table, there's a Table Tools context-sensitive ribbon. I'm going to click on Design, and all the way over in Properties, Group Table Name. Click, and I'm going to call this Blood Pressure T, and then I'm going to hit Enter. That way, if we make any formulas, the formula will actually show the table name and the field name. It's quite amazing. Now, let's make a chart to start this off and see this amazing dynamic range. So I'm going to highlight. The first, only the first two columns and the data. And now I'm going to go up to Insert. And over in the Charts group, I'm going to say Column. Now, just quickly, I'm going to do some formatting. Let's see if we can click on the line. Sometimes it's hard. Make sure it's not the square, but it's the lines. You can use your arrow keys to cycle through all the chart elements. When you see the lines, delete. Let's click on the axis, delete. Let's come over to the pluses and say data labels. And that's all we're going to do for here. Now, let's point to the corner, click and drag. All we're doing, the goal in this video, is just to see the table feature in action. And what is it going to do? It's going to add new columns as I add new records. Now, there's a few ways you can add records. You can actually just click below. I'm going to use the keyboard for today's date, Control Semicolon Tab. Oh, look at that. It actually carries the format forward. I can already see that my chart is updated. That is simply amazing. Oh, this was a stressful day. I'm in big trouble. I'm back up at 149, and this was 93. Now, another way to add new records is if you're in the last cell, in the last record in your table, Tab will add a new record. And now this is going to be 10/29, Tab. Finally, back down to 131, and this was 87. That is simply amazing. Now, let's do a formula here. Max. I'm just going to put a label here. Maybe go up and do a little formatting. Fill. Font. Border. You know, I could have come down here and gone right-click the mini toolbar, and then some of the most common formatting features like border, all borders. All right, so now I want to do equals max. Oh, the max function. The max function will tell us the biggest number in a range. So we see our screen tips. For numbers, I'm simply going to highlight. Now, when we highlight this, it will tell us the table name and the field name. And look at that. It's given us the field names in square brackets. That's called table formula nomenclature. Just think of it as polite. It's telling you, hey, that's the table and that's the field. Now, we'll have to get used to these square brackets for some formulas we make in Excel. And when we learn Access, the database program for Microsoft, when we build queries, we'll see that the field names are going to be in square brackets. Let's come over here and do min. And watch this. I'm going to highlight and right-click and point to my mini toolbar and get the paintbrush or format painter. Boop. And that will allow me to click in some cell. You can see the paintbrush there. And it will copy just the formatting and place it there. All right, now I'm going to do equals min. And I want to do something strange here just to show you how cool this table feature is. Notice this is J35 to J40. Type in cell references is kind of risky. I'm going to try it. J35. Immediately I can see it up there, so that's kind of helpful. And then colon J, let's see, is it J39? Let's see, J39. Oh, wait a second, it's not 39. Type in is always tough for me. 40. Oh, okay. So it's looking at the same range. I'm going to control enter and then hit F2. You notice it brings it up to capitals. I just wanted to do that to show you that this range will expand. That 40 will turn to 41 when I start adding new records. So on 10/30, it was 125. And this was 84. Now, I'm not going to hit tab because I don't want to add a new record. I'm going to hit enter. That won't add a new record. It's only tab. And now let's look at the max. Oh, OK, so that's not going to change as I add new records. It's just polite. It's saying, hey, I got the blood pressure table and the field right there. F2 on this one. But look at that. Explicitly, that formula is updating. 35 now to 41. So the Excel table feature can be quite amazing. One other thing. You can use it to sort. I think that's off the screen there. So I have to scroll down a little bit. You can use it to sort. And later in the class, we'll see how to use a filter. So formatting, drop-downs for sorting and filtering, and dynamic ranges. That's the Excel table. As long as you have a proper data set with field names, records, and rows, you can convert it to an Excel table. And we, of course, have our 5 rules for proper data set. All right, we'll see you next video.